human conditions, not free market propaganda and corrupt politicians, cause they owned by special interest groups that fund their campaign. That's why you hear the same old things they claim.
Welcome to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. This week on the program, in the first segment, we speak with independent journalist and author Kevin Gosztola, author of Guilty of Journalism, about the case of Julian Assange. Gosztola joins us to talk about the Council of Europe parliamentarians' vote that agreed that Julian Assange was in fact a political prisoner. Assange recently spoke to the parliament and urged them to oppose the U.S. government's transnational repression and assaults on journalists and press freedoms around the world. Later in the program, we're joined by media scholar Steve Macek. We'll talk about foreign spending to influence U.S. elections, and how it goes well beyond Russian covert operations, in fact, involves many other countries and even other entities. But are the corporate media paying attention? We'll talk again with Steve Macek to find out how they're not and what you need to know about the influence of dark money in advance of election 2024. Stay tuned for an all-new Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio.
Prisons, build the capacity, citizens, and the times for the master thief, combine and conquer, steal a masterpiece, open your eyes and realize what's happening, times running out to reach all potential fame at the table. Then you probably...
Welcome to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. In this segment today, we welcome back to the program independent journalist and author Kevin Gosztola. Kevin's pretty regular on the Project Censored Show for a number of years. He's been a go-to source on the case of Julian Assange and whistleblowers in particular. Gosztola spent the last decade plus reporting on Assange, WikiLeaks, and the wider war on whistleblowers. He is now the curator of the Dissenter newsletter, also producer and co-host of the weekly podcast Unauthorized Disclosure. His work has appeared in The Nation, Salon, Common Dreams, Truthout, and many other places. He's been on Democracy Now!, The Real News Network, Al Jazeera English, and more. And of course, no stranger to this audience, Kevin Gosztola is, of course, the author of a book published by the Censored Press and Seven Stories, that is Guilty of Journalism, The Political Case Against Julian Assange. And Kevin, welcome back to the program. Here we are again talking about Julian Assange because there's more in the news after he was freed. It's been a while since you've been on. I still say this is the definitive source, your book, on a history of that case and for people to understand the implications of it for press freedoms. Bring us up to speed, Kevin Gosztola.
We heard from WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange. He gave testimony in Strasbourg, France, before something that is known as the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe. It's a European Union body. It's supposed to be a kind of norm-setting institution for reviewing human rights, for trying to promote human rights and democracy. And essentially, before he was freed from Belmarsh prison, there was an effort, I believe it was spearheaded by an Icelandic parliamentarian. She stood up for Julian Assange and did a fact-finding visit to Belmarsh, met with him last year. And so there was an effort within this body to then have Julian come to the assembly and speak to them, submit testimony, and then they would vote on this resolution that basically said very clearly Julian Assange was a political prisoner when he was detained and prosecuted by the United States, detained by the UK at the behest of the US, and then faced this political prosecution. So he said very clearly, I am free today after years of incarceration because I pled guilty to journalism. I pled guilty to seeking information from a source. I pled guilty to obtaining information from a source. And I pled guilty to informing the public what that information was. I did not plead guilty to anything else. And before that, he said, I want to be totally clear. I am not free today because the system worked.
Wow. That's a pretty powerful statement. And again, tying it into journalism, I mean, I remember when you and I talked over summer, of course, there was cause for celebration, given the fact that he was, quote, being freed from confinement. But under those conditions, the powers that be, going back to the United States, essentially they did get a sliver of what they wanted. They were able to criminalize journalistic activity and behavior. Kevin Gosztola, in your mind, does that still stand as some type of precedent? And why should we still be concerned that he was found guilty of journalism?
What if I just stick with Julian Assange's words to respond to your question, which is a very good one? What he told the assembly in his speech, "As I emerge, the truth now seems less discernible, and I regret how much ground has been lost during that time period, how expressing the truth has been undermined, attacked, weakened, and diminished. I see more impunity, more secrecy, more retaliation for telling the truth, more self-censorship. It's hard not to draw a line from the U.S. government's prosecution of me. It's crossing the Rubicon by internationally criminalizing journalism to the chilled climate for freedom of expression that exists now." So as he spoke about WikiLeaks, he was constantly connecting it to this moment. And I'll just say, since a lot of Julian Assange coming to this assembly was about how much is he still physically and mentally intact, I imagine people listening would like my opinion on how he seemed and whether we think he could still be the kind of figure he was, or was he totally destroyed by the United States? And I could tell that he was extremely nervous when he stepped before that body. He had not been in a setting like this for 6 or 7 years, particularly in person. There were opportunities from within the embassy to log on to speak to conferences or forums, the way that NSA whistleblower Edward Snowden has done regularly from his exile in Russia. But Julian Assange was there. He had Stella Assange on his right, who's his wife, and he had Christian Hrafnsson, the WikiLeaks editor-in-chief, on his left. So he was able to be put at ease while he fielded questions from the parliamentarians. But it was a tough time, I think, for him to get through the speech that he had prepared. But then, as he began to get asked questions by these parliamentarians, he eased up. And I was very pleased that I was able to see the Julian Assange that I think we've all been missing, who could take these questions and answer. He had an opportunity to respond a bit to what he called transnational repression. This is apparently a phrase that is becoming popular in global human rights organization circles, of how you see powers like the United States who are trampling over the different laws in individual countries so that they can push their interests. And so he was able to field all of these questions. But what he was traumatized by quite clearly, and I think people should spend some time to think about this, is he told us all very clearly that he was not ready to talk about the hangings that he had seen in Belmarsh, the violence that he had witnessed, that is something that has scarred him. And when he was asked a question about Belmarsh, he really shirked from giving anybody any response about the conditions and what he had gone through. So as far as I can tell, he is still recovering. He's been able to have access to medical care, some mental health care. He's had several months in Melbourne, Australia with his family thus far. And I got to give him a lot of credit. He stood up to a lot of the paranoia that he could have subjected himself to or let rule him. And he traveled to France. I mean, there are people out there who say, how could you leave Australia? Don't you think you would be picked up by any of these US-backed authorities, US-influenced, US-pressured authorities that might want to stop you and harass you and intimidate you some more? But he went there and he spoke, and the parliamentarians actually listened. They gave him a standing ovation, and then they passed this resolution that, by the way, as I conclude this remark here, wasn't just to say Julian Assange was a political prisoner. It clearly sent a message to the U.S. government that they need to reform the Espionage Act because it is in conflict with our freedom of speech rules and laws in the United States, and that it puts all people around the world at risk because of what the Justice Department is willing to do to go after people who are not U.S. citizens.
Indeed, Kevin Gosztola, in the remarks that you can read at thedissenter.org, you have a transcript of the prepared remarks from Julian Assange, and he talks right from the outset. He actually talks about his experience of isolation, making things very difficult to him. He said at the outset that he wasn't equipped to speak about what he endured there. He even apologized in advance. I think it took an extraordinary amount of courage for him to do what he did, given what he has been subject to over many, many years. And let's remember, as you just said, to reiterate, he said transnational repression cannot become the norm here, and that the criminalization of news gathering activities is a threat to investigative journalism everywhere. And Assange said, quote, "I was formally convicted by a foreign power for asking for, receiving, and publishing truthful information about that power while I was in Europe. The fundamental issue is simple. Journalists should not be prosecuted for doing their jobs. Journalism is not a crime. It is a pillar of a free and informed society." How significant do you think this is, actually? Moving beyond the realms of people like you and I, we see this as, of course, it's an incredible symbolic statement of stating the obvious and the truthfulness of it. What do you think the traction is at pushing back against the attacks on journalism, especially now in the United States, and we'll get to this later, when we're seeing Democrats calling openly to deplatform and censor certain groups, that they've lost control of the narrative on social media, trying to shut down TikTok specifically because of Gaza content, as Mitt Romney said openly. And that's the Democrats, not even to mention Trump and the Republicans. They're talking about openly attacking and arresting and deporting journalists. These statements of Assange shouldn't just be symbolic. They're another clarion call. It's another warning that if we don't get really busy and collectively stand up against this, we're not going to have much journalism left.
Oh, yeah. When you say we're not going to have much journalism left, I can't not think of, and I won't go on and on about it because you spent many times with other more knowledgeable people on your show, but I can't not think of the constant hemorrhaging of jobs in the industry and just the loss of people and how much we are not in a state where we can fight some of these issues because people are just so broken when it comes to the lack of funding, the lack of resources in order to do what we do on a regular basis. And so you say, is this just symbolic? And I think the significance of this is a little bit more than being symbolic, for the fact that this is European countries that are extremely deferential to US power. And in order for them to pass this, they also included a section that scolded one of their own member states, the United Kingdom, for allowing the United States to detain Julian Assange in Belmarsh prison. And it paid attention to the abuse that Julian Assange suffered in that prison, prompting one of their members, who was actually the chair of this proceeding when Julian Assange testified, to complain that it was inappropriate to label Julian Assange as a political prisoner, that it somehow diminished what that meant. And like, political prisoners are only supposed to be people in Russia, but Julian Assange, to call him that, he wasn't detained and tortured, was this guy's insistence. And they just ignored him. They disregarded it and they voted on the resolution and they passed it. And they sent a message and it's clear. And I think people might not think this has a lot of value, but to me, having been in this work for 10 or 15 years, I do think that it's not the end all be all, but to remove the mask from power and to be able to see clearly when there's a lot of those out there who have these illusions or delusions about where the US stands on human rights and democracy, I think it's immensely valuable. Julian Assange and his people would say it's immensely valuable for those European countries, their parliamentarians, to take a stand and say to the US that they're not buying it. So it's good to see them. It's long overdue, but it's good to see them standing up. And, you know, I have to think of Julian Assange and his associates and his family and how they cheered and how they were very pleased that they were finally able to be recognized for what they had gone through. And now this is a means for them to move on and do whatever comes next for Assange and WikiLeaks. We'll have to be patient. I don't know that Julian Assange is going to return to running WikiLeaks. This is the sort of thing that has to be in the books so that he can point to it when he resumes life. So I was a political prisoner. I was persecuted. The Council of Europe recognized that that's what the United States did to me. And so now I'm back to work as editor-in-chief, trying to promote transparency and give human rights activists and whistleblowers a space for exposing worldwide corruption.
Indeed. And Kevin Gosztola, you wrote at the dissenter, altogether, the passage of a resolution recognizing that Assange was a political prisoner was an overdue act of solidarity with a journalist and acknowledgement of another prosecution like it could easily happen. If European countries do not stand up for media freedom and freedom of expression, you noted that the Secretary General for the International Federation of Journalists praised the vote, saying, quote, it's a victory for press freedom, for all journalists across the world, and for Assange after 12 years deprived of freedom. The fight for truth has never been so necessary. So again, not symbolic, should be some real meaning and real action based on this, and should spur people to really think seriously about protecting press freedoms for everyone. I'd like to remind folks that we're the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. Our guest is author and independent journalist Kevin Gosztola. He's author of Guilty of Journalism.
Just a quick thing to make it clear. This body, when it passes resolutions, believes that it is setting a norm when it comes to what they see unfolding with the war in Ukraine and Russia's aggression. And so if that's how they take themselves seriously, then we can take this resolution as seriously as well, which is to say that the U.S. State Department would see what they passed and hold it up as a counter to Russia. So this should have meaning as well.
Well, we'd hope so, but as the late, great George Carlin once quipped, let's not have a double standard here. One standard will do just fine. But in this case, particularly with the United States, double standards and hypocrisies, that's sort of the MO. That's the rule of the day. If it suits their fancy, then they'll hold it up every time. If it doesn't, it's just a garbage, inconsequential, irrelevant political agenda from some nefarious group. I mean, it's almost comical. It's so idiotically obvious that they just don't get called out on this. Or is it just the fact that the United States is so brazen and so powerful worldwide that they just don't fear any kind of repercussions or being called out on such extraordinary ethical violations and double standards? Kevin Gosztola.
Your real talk is valid because this is the same body that did their own review. And I think it was almost around the exact same time that the Senate was looking into torture by the CIA. They did their own study into how the CIA had used European territories, European countries, to facilitate the rendition and torture of people in the global war on terrorism. That was passed. I can't say that the U.S. really gave that too much weight. So this is just to say, if we keep them at center, and they're the ones that I think are the wild card, we know how U.S. power will act. Whatever the European parliamentarians want to do, it's their countries. If they don't want to be pushed around and coerced and told what to do by the U.S. anymore, this is a grand opportunity to start owning their human rights and not catering to what the U.S. tells them to do, which is to say they don't have to keep political prisoners in their prisons like Julian Assange, who are journalists, award-winning journalists. And as we move on, I do want to say that Julian Assange made this observation about the collateral murder video, which is just very quickly remind your listeners of what I'm talking about. This is the video from 2007 of U.S. soldiers in an Apache helicopter killing a couple Reuters employees, yep, one of them a cameraman, and then also shooting on a van that pulled up to try and rescue them when they were wounded. There were two children in the vehicle. So Julian Assange said that he recalled releasing this video and he spoke about WikiLeaks work. And as he continued to share this, he basically said that what is devastating to him is that now there is a kind of collateral murder video that seems to be happening almost every day. And he was particularly referring to Gaza. As he went through and he was describing what happened with Chelsea Manning and her disclosures, I think he was really just grappling with what it was like to leave prison. Remember, when he was in prison, he didn't have this constant stream of video from social media that he could see. Now, as a free man, he's able to look online just like all of us, and he's dealing with the videos of children, the videos of hospitals being blown up, and all of this carnage that we've been exposed to over the last year.
Kevin Gosztola, that's a good segue into some other things we wanted to talk about. Shooting the messenger is, of course, age-old tactic of the powerful. And unfortunately, that's literally what's happening. It's been a year. I'm speaking to you on October 8th. October 7th was the one-year anniversary of the Hamas attacks on the Nova Music Festival in Israel. And of course, Israel has been retaliating ever since. And the Committee to Protect Journalists, and of course, many groups, but especially CPJ, we've also been cataloging this. There are record numbers of journalists that have been killed, arrested in Palestine since this began. So it's highly likely that Assange was referring to this. I mean, the numbers are just off the chart. At least, according to the CPJ, at least 128 journalists and media workers have been killed in the last year. More journalists have died in the course of in any year that CPJ has begun documenting journalist killings. And they've been doing this since 1992. Kevin, we could suspect, of course, that this is an undercount. Of course, one of the retorts to this often that we hear from the State Department or from the Israeli government is that it's Hamas. Somehow they're not journalists. They're just terrorists with microphones or something. Can you comment on, you know, some of these developments?
This is nothing less than a Israeli government that is backed and funded by the U.S., receiving an endless flow of arms shipments. I saw the number. It's closing on $18 billion worth of weaponry that has been sent there. So these are the weapons that are killing these journalists. It's estimated by a coalition of volunteer doctors who have been in Gaza that the death toll is actually probably around 118,000 people, though they've been able to officially account some 41 to 42,000 people. When the rubble settles and if you were able to actually go in and do an accounting, it would be far, far higher. So when you consider all of this, they are executing journalists. Reporters Without Borders were able to find more than 30 examples of people being threatened and or harassed, intimidated, targeted. There was an example on October 6th. I just want to introduce this. You know, it's good to be specific, because if you speak in generalities, then people can say you're just defending Hamas or you're just being anti-Semitic. Well, here's what happened on October 6th. Journalist by the name of Hassan Hamad was 19 years old and was living in the Jabalia refugee camp, which has been terrorized by the Israeli military forces for the last months. And a Middle East Eye reporter named Maha Husseini reported that Hamad had received threatening phone calls and text messages in the months before. And on October 6th, was killed, was executed. A shell was fired directly and specifically at Hassan's bedroom to intentionally target him, said Ashraf Mashharawi, who is part of this Media Town production company where Hamad worked. And Barry Malone, he's a deputy editor-in-chief for the Thomson Reuters Foundation, which is like the same Reuters that I was speaking about with collateral murder. He said, I just saw the remains of Palestinian journalist Hassan Hamad reduced to a plastic bag and a shoebox. According to a fresh tally from CPJ, 123 journalists have now been killed in Israeli strikes. If you're a journalist and you're not speaking out in solidarity, why? And I think that's the critical question. Because we've seen such a lack of solidarity from American journalists here in the country. We don't know the names of these people who have been executed. You can name Evan Gershkovich. He was in a prison in Russia. But you can't name, even as we've had a record number of journalists killed, far, far more so than the war in Ukraine.
Yeah, it's absolutely riveting, Kevin. And, you know, just this past week, Ta-Nehisi Coates was subject to really disgraceful racist attacks from CBS talking head when describing the apartheid situation in Gaza, and is now making some rounds. Was recently interviewed by Mehdi Hussein, who was himself let go from MSNBC because he was being too objective about what was happening. There's a concerted attack. Let's not forget the attack on Coates from a white male talking head going after a black male scholar and best-selling author, basically telling him to keep his anti-racism in his lane and don't apply it to other people, was, I mean, absolutely despicable television. It was despicable. I can't call it journalism. And I don't agree with everything Coates has ever done or written. That's not the point. I think it's important that we stand up and acknowledge that these kinds of attacks are significantly accelerating. I don't want to pretend that that's as egregious of an attack as the death of journalists. What I'm saying is that the rippling effects is they're the worst in Gaza. But as they ripple out, there are still attacks against all kinds of people, including people within the establishment itself, that cannot even begin to speak these objective truths about what's happening without being smeared as extremist or smeared as anti-Semitic. And as you and I talked off air, Seth Stern, Freedom of Press Foundation, just recently wrote again about something that we talked about months ago on the Project Censored show with Associate Director Andy Lee Roth and Seth Stern himself, is that there's a revived effort now in the U.S. government to use the IRS to go after 501c3 nonprofit tax-exempt organizations, including Americans for Justice and Palestine Educational Foundation, Jewish Voices for Peace, and others. They're now targeting these groups to go after their nonprofit status to take away their ability to continue to produce this kind of information in these reports because they ideologically disagree with what these organizations are doing. Kevin Gosztola, in the couple minutes we have here in this segment, what are your thoughts on these draconian elements that are now claiming that they already have the government power to do this through IRS code and they don't even need a new law based on anti-terrorism laws from 9/11?
It's terrible, and it shows that the people like us who have been warning why we needed to repeal the infrastructure, the post 9/11 legal structures, because they would be a threat to our liberties, to our freedoms, to produce journalism, to engage in assembly and all of that, that more people who are like-minded should have recognized the urgent message that we were putting forward and taken it up. This is a dark moment. I mean, here in Chicago, where I'm based just a little bit north at Northwestern University, Stephen Thrasher was fired, a journalism professor, for supporting his students while they exercised their freedom of assembly and gathered on campus. So we just need to think about this going forward here. We don't have time to get into it, but I do want to just briefly and very quickly mention the censorship regime in Israel that has shut down Al Jazeera, the West Bank Bureau. It's also been used to shut down Al Mayadeen, which is a Lebanese broadcast TV. And then there's a radio station there called Dream that was shut down. And so this is not the democracy in the Middle East. That's a very racist way of viewing the Middle East, like the Arab countries are not capable of running their countries without the U.S. interfering and meddling and the CIA toppling their regimes and imposing new leaders. No, the Israeli government, with the support of the U.S., is destabilizing the world and making the world more unsafe for journalists.
Kevin Gosztola, well put, and we'll have to wrap the segment here, but we should revisit this because, again, I mentioned this in passing earlier in our conversation, and you just alluded to it again. The censorship regime is alive and well, and it isn't just coming from the Trump end of the political spectrum, and it's not just the specter of Project 2025 at the Heritage Foundation. Prominent Democratic figures like Hillary Clinton and John Kerry are worrying about losing control and cracking down on social media. There is a lot going on right now that I think we need to be paying close attention to. Again, I think we have a lot of work cut out for us. Kevin Gosztola, any last words in the segment today on the Project Censored show?
Well, just look, it's my belief that the threat from Donald Trump through Project 2025 is severe, but we should not discount the threat from an administration, President Joe Biden's administration, and a vice president who is running for office, who has basically said, I don't care if this destruction is happening. I don't care if all this killing of journalists is happening. I think I can still win without doing anything to stop this carnage. And that, to me, has really been difficult as a conscientious person who cares about human rights and these principles of freedom.
Absolutely. Kevin Gosztola, author of Guilty of Journalism, The Political Case Against Julian Assange. You can read more of Kevin's work at thedissenter.org. Kevin Gosztola, thanks as always for your time and your astute analysis. We greatly appreciate it here at the Project Censored show. Coming up next on the Project Censored show, I will be joined by media scholar Dr. Steve Macek. We're going to be talking about a recent dispatch he wrote for Project Censored on media and politics. Foreign spending to influence U.S. elections goes well beyond Russian covert operations. But are the corporate media Paying attention? Stay tuned and find out on the Project Censored Show. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. In this segment, we welcome back media scholar Steve Macek. Steve Macek is certainly no stranger to the Project Censored audience. He is professor of communications and chair of Department of Communications and Media Studies at North Central College in Illinois. He teaches courses on the First Amendment, journalism history, media policy and criticism, as well as urban studies. He serves on the editorial board of the journal Communication and Democracy and steering committee of the Union for Democratic Communications. His most recent book, co-edited with Nolan Higdon and Robin Anderson, is Censorship, Digital Media, and the Global Crackdown on Free Expression. Steve Macek, welcome back to the Project Censored Show.
Thanks for having me, Mickey.
You recently wrote a piece, Foreign Spending to Influence U.S. Elections Goes Well Beyond Russian Covert Operations, but are the corporate media paying attention? And that's a great question, because the corporate media really seemed to pay an awful lot of attention to Russia, 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 and what's Russia doing, and what's Trump doing with Putin next? And there certainly is something to look at as far as some Russian meddling. But as we've covered for years at Project Censored, that story has been overblown. In fact, it's almost a fake news story of its own cottage industry at MSNBC at this juncture.
Right.
Somehow we don't have any other things trying to influence nefariously or insidiously the otherwise perfect electoral system we have. Right, Steve Macek?
Right. And I think that's how I sort of frame, you know, my argument in this piece, is that there's been this sort of inordinate, disproportionate amount of attention to Russian meddling in U.S. elections. It's certainly the case that it is not the most effective foreign interference in an American election in history, as the New York Times claimed. That claim is completely outrageous. And the fact of the matter is that this narrow focus on Russian meddling in elections, or in the right-wing media, there's a sort of narrow focus on maybe undocumented immigrants voting in elections. Research on that has demonstrated that maybe like 100 undocumented immigrants voted in the past 1 billion votes cast in the United States. This is the Heritage Foundation research. Meanwhile, I think much more effective and much more damaging to democracy is the influence on elections that comes through the spending of dark money by foreign influenced corporations and spending by foreign lobbyists, registered foreign agents who are in the pay of foreign governments and are allowed under U.S. law, if they're U.S. citizens, to spend money on elections. And my piece sort of tries to tease out just how much money is being spent by foreign influenced or foreign owned corporations here in the United States to sway elections, and how much money is being spent by foreign lobbyists.
So, Steve, you mentioned the Heritage Foundation a minute ago, and of course, I just couldn't help but think of Project 2025 and the fact that they're a nonprofit and they're not supposed to be in the game of influence peddling in the election either. And yet they're the ones that did the study that found that some of their own claims about illegal immigrants voting,
or some of the Trump MAGA claims about illegal immigrants voting, were just completely bogus.
Just tell our listeners, real quick, a primer.
Dark money is any spending by an individual, a corporation, or organization that's designed to influence the outcome of elections or influence the political process where the source of that money is not disclosed. And a pair of Supreme Court cases back in 2010, Citizens United versus FEC and SpeechNow.org versus FEC, the Supreme Court held that any kind of legal restriction on independent political expenditures by corporations or unions or nonprofits violates the First Amendment, and that those organizations may raise and spend unlimited amounts of money on elections as long as they don't coordinate their spending with candidates, parties, and campaigns. Now, if the spending is by what is called a super PAC, political action committee, the names of the donors do have to be disclosed. And a lot of the independent political spending in elections is done by super PACs. However, there are other nonprofits that, you know, are tax-exempt organizations like 501c4 social welfare organizations who are prohibited from spending the majority of their budget on political activity, but can spend money on political activity, who do not have to disclose their donors. And so what is happening, and what has been well documented by groups like Open Secrets, and I wrote about in an article for Progressive Magazine, what I wrote about is the fact that a lot of these 501c4 social welfare organizations are essentially laundering money for corporations and billionaires and millionaires, taking that money and then in turn contributing money to super PACs, which is a way of obscuring the source of the money. It makes it impossible to trace where some of the money, at least some of the money that's going to influence our elections, that's paying for ads, that's paying for election-related research, where that money is coming from. So dark money is a huge problem, and it's a growing problem. Since 2010, when this became legal, thanks to these two Supreme Court rulings, corporate campaign finance watchdog organization Open Secrets has tracked more than $2.8 billion in dark money that has flooded into our elections. More than $2.8 billion. And the amount of dark money that is being expended on elections at every level, not just at the federal level, the amount of dark money being expended on elections continues to grow. And the thing that is very concerning for me and that I write about in this piece is that the same kind of loophole that allows wealthy corporations and billionaires like the Koch brothers to spend millions in dark money in an attempt to influence the outcome of elections also permits U.S. corporations that are subsidiaries of foreign companies or have significant foreign ownership to pour untraceable money into elections. Now, it is illegal under U.S. law, under federal law, it is illegal for foreign nationals to spend any money, either directly or indirectly, intended to influence U.S. elections. That is a violation of U.S. law. And yet, this dark money loophole allows corporations that have significant foreign ownership, maybe subsidiaries of foreign companies that are operating in the U.S. or have, you know, individual foreign ownership that's significant, it allows them to spend money just the way any other corporation can in an attempt to influence elections. And just to give your listeners a sense of how big a problem this is, the fact is that according to research, something like 40% of all U.S. corporate equity, all outstanding shares of U.S. companies, is owned by foreign investors. There are many well-known corporations that most Americans think of as American brands, like Anheuser-Busch, owned by a Belgian corporation, the Bayer German Corporation, yep, owned by a German company. 7-Eleven is owned by a Japanese holding company. GE Appliances is now a subsidiary of a Chinese company. So there are lots and lots of foreign companies that hold or control what we think of as American brands and operate in the U.S. who in turn are able to give money to influence the outcome of elections.
But hey, Steve, isn't that the reason why the Congress banned TikTok, is that they were foreign owned
yes,
by dance in China?
Exactly. That was the claim. But, you know, Congress is happy to scapegoat a single platform. They're happy to scapegoat a single platform. And as I've said in another context, if Congress was really serious about addressing the risks to citizens posed by TikTok, they would pass some sort of data privacy law that would apply to all the social media. TikTok shouldn't be able to harvest our private data. Neither should YouTube.
But let's not forget, I mean, I know I've said this on several shows, but I have to say it anytime I get the opportunity. This summer, Mitt Romney said the quiet part out loud at the McCain Institute Forum or whatever it is. He said, well, look, we all know the reason that we're having to shut down TikTok is because the kids are on it and they're learning about Gaza. They're going after specific ideological sites.
No, absolutely. They're trying to silence specific ideological perspectives. There's no question. And I agree with you that the real reason they're going after TikTok is because they're unable to control the sort of viral political information that's being spread there. This is the same reason why authoritarian governments around the world are shutting down Telegram or Signal, because they cannot control the kind of communication that's taking place.
But we digress. We're now talking about how they're trying to crack down and control certain things, but they open up wide these dark money paths.
Yes.
To allow a different kind of control.
And so, you know, I'll just go back to what I was saying, that these loopholes that were created by the Supreme Court ruling in Citizens United and Free Speech Now allow foreign influence companies, companies that are subsidiaries of foreign companies, to spend money to sway the outcome of elections. And they're representing the fiduciary interests of these foreign shareholders. They're not interested in upholding the national interest or the interest of the American people. So let me give you an example, which I cite in the piece. The oil and gas giants BP and Shell are both wholly owned subsidiaries of foreign corporations. They're both foreign companies that have U.S. subsidiaries. They're also both members of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, which is a major source of dark money spending, a major font of dark money spending. They shell out millions each year in electioneering communication in support of candidates that they favor, and the chamber refuses to disclose its members or how much they each contribute to the funding of the organization's vast, because they're also one of the top lobbyists in Washington, their vast lobbying and political influence operations. They refuse to disclose the members. Now, some of the members self-disclose, but they refuse to disclose the members or how much they're contributing to the organization. As a result, there's absolutely no way of knowing how much of the dark money that the U.S. Chamber of Commerce is spending originates with foreign-owned or foreign-connected companies like Shell and BP. That should concern all of us. This is an issue that has been largely ignored by the corporate media. There have been a few exceptional cases, and I mentioned in the article the fact that a couple of years ago, the Federal Election Commission, which is completely broken, by the way, and we could come back to talking about the FEC and what's wrong with it in a second. The FEC fined Canadian billionaire Barry Zekelman's businesses nearly $1 million because his businesses in the U.S. had made $1.75 million in illegal campaign contributions to the America First Action pro-Trump super PAC in 2018. And the fine was so unusual because the FEC rarely enforces election law, rarely enforces campaign finance law. And it was such a large fine that it actually received some coverage in like Newsweek and New York Times. But my guess is that none of your listeners ever heard about it because they covered it when it happened and then it just disappeared. The story just disappeared. Sadly, the FEC's fines against Zekelman received more coverage in Canada than it did here in the United States, where he violated the election laws, the country whose election laws he violated. That's, I think, very telling. And there's a lot of questions about, like, why is this? Is it that reporters, these corporate news organizations just don't care that there's all this apparent corruption and rampant violations of U.S. election laws taking place? That could be part of it. I think a lot of it has to do with the fact that thanks to budget cuts and layoffs and so on, even corporate newsrooms are reduced to skeleton staffs. They don't have as many investigative reporters as they used to. They don't have as many reporters assigned to particular beats like, say, campaign finance.
Where is the dark money beat? It's in the dark.
Yeah, so the dark money beat is in the dark. It has been cut. And so in some ways, it's a casualty of the downsizing. There's just nobody left to cover it. And it requires a certain degree of special skills, or at least attention to these filings with the FEC, paying attention to the paper trail to be able to cover this story effectively.
You've got to be privy to it. You've got to have a background in it, or you've got to know where to look for it if it's not obvious. These things all come together to create the perfect storm of why mis and disinformation also thrives, because we have a dearth of people in the major news outlets capable of and willing to address.
Exactly. There's a few reporters who like routinely cover it, but otherwise we have to rely on a few very underfunded watchdog organizations like Open Secrets or Citizens for Responsibility and Ethics in Washington, Peru. They both do an amazing job of tracking dark money spending as well as they can. Ralph Nader's organizations as well, Public Citizen, you know, Common Cause, they try to track this, but it is such a big problem. If you believe what Open Secrets says, and since 2010, we've been confronted with $2.8 billion in dark money spending, then it's a problem that's too large for these small nonprofit watchdog organizations to really deal with.
I need to remind everybody, you're tuned to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. We are speaking to Professor Steve Macek. He's a professor of communication and chair of the Department of Communication Media Studies at North Central College. He is, of course, also a contributor to Project Censored's yearbook, our Deja Vu chapters, the Top 25, our affiliates program. We're going to continue this conversation with Steve Macek. We're talking about a recent article he did as a dispatch on media and politics for us at projectcensored.org. Foreign spending to influence U.S. elections goes well beyond Russian covert operations, but are the corporate media paying attention? And Steve, in the beginning of your article, and I know you want to move on, but you did mention in the beginning of your article that some people may have caught wind of more of this, of course, because of Russia, the recent media infatuation again ongoing with Russiagate. You mentioned the Republican campaign strategist Jesse Benton was sentenced last year for soliciting illegal contributions from a Russian businessman to the Trump campaign. And of course, most recently, Eric Adams
has been indicted with taking illegal campaign contributions from a Turkish businessman. The allegation is that it was part of a quid pro quo to change some of the regulations around the building of a skyscraper in Manhattan and other things. And those kinds of stories, those individual violations, do bubble to the surface. And it could be that the charges against Eric Adams may bring him down as mayor. So it's not as though there aren't the occasional story. There aren't occasional stories that are covered by the corporate media. But the more systematic kind of influence, the spending of dark money by foreign-influenced and foreign-owned corporations, mostly is just ignored. Another, and I wanted to kind of move on to another kind of channel of foreign influence on our elections that doesn't get the attention from the corporate media that it really deserves, and that is campaign contributions made by foreign lobbyists. So there is this law called the Foreign Agents Registration Act that requires that any individuals or organizations engaged in lobbying or advocacy for foreign interests in the U.S. have to register with the Department of Justice, have to report their activities. If they're circulating pieces of propaganda, they have to give copies of that propaganda to the Department of Justice, and they have to disclose any pay they receive. So it imposes real transparency requirements on these registered foreign agents. And according to Open Secrets, during the 2020 election cycle, registered foreign agents, individuals or entities engaged in lobbying for foreign interests, spent $8.5 million in political contributions. And another $25 million in 2020 political contributions came from lobbyists representing foreign clients, including U.S. subsidiaries owned or controlled by foreign parent companies. So that's a significant amount of money. And the Quincy Institute for Responsible Statecraft released a more recent study that found that in 2022 and 2023, FARA, registered foreign agents, reported spending $14.3 million in political contributions. And why this should be concerning to us is that among the top five foreign countries that were most active under FARA were Saudi Arabia and the UAE.
Also Ukraine, but that seems fine.
But I mean, they're spending outrageous sums of money in order to try to influence, through their lobbyists, to influence our elections. And the example that I talk about in a lot of detail has to do with Saudi Arabia. This is a, I think, scandal. I'd like to see more research and more reporting on this. But Norm Coleman, who is a former Republican senator for Minnesota, is a registered foreign agent representing the interests of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. And Responsible Statecraft in 2020 reported that Coleman and his colleagues at the law firm of Hogan Lovells have a $175,000 per month lobbying contract with Saudi Arabia. Okay, what's the objection to that? Well, the problem is that Coleman is also the founder and chairman of one of the biggest super PACs, Republican super PACs in Washington, the Congressional Leadership Fund, which is a super PAC that raised and spent $165 million to elect Republicans to the House of Representatives in 2019 and 2020. He also runs a dark money group called the American Action Network, which is a 501c3 social welfare organization that can devote up to 49% of its spending on electioneering and is not required to disclose its donors. So he is somebody who has his hand on the spigots of a lot of dark money, and he is a registered lobbyist for Saudi Arabia. Well, you would think this would be a story that the corporate media, the establishment press, would be all over. This is a smoking gun. And in fact, the New York Times, Washington Post, you know, Wall Street Journal have run maybe a dozen articles on Saudi lobbying that mention him in passing. There's never an article that really talks about him at any great length. The most substantial treatment of his role was a 2018 Washington Post article on the Saudis' Washington influence. It mentioned that he founded a super PAC, but it didn't mention the super PAC by name or mention how much money the super PAC has control over. So it's really unbelievable. Because then the same corporate media have also reported on the Congressional Leadership Fund as an important super PAC and mentioned how much money has been raised, but they never connect the dots.
So, you know, this begs the question, and I know that you'll conclude on a couple things here, but, you know, there's other, obviously, a lot of other things in the news. But, you know, what strikes me as interesting is one of the biggest lobbies in Washington is AIPAC.
That's a really good point.
We don't really ever hear about much of what goes on with that.
And they have spent a ton of money this past election cycle.
And look, let's not forget, they were founded by a lobbyist for the Israeli government.
They were founded by an Israeli lobbyist. And there's some evidence that the Israeli government is worried about all the pro-Israeli groups in the United States being designated as registered foreign agents. And The Guardian came out with a story in August, I think it was, about some hacked emails from the Israeli government where legal counsel for some of the groups that were involved in pro-Israeli lobbying in the U.S. was like fretting about whether or not the Department of Justice and the IRS would require some of these groups to register as foreign agents. Because if they do, then the Department of Justice gets all of this information about their activities, has to get copies of any propaganda they're circulating. They have to register all the people who are working for them.
Well, the propaganda that they're circulating is coming out of the mouths of political candidates.
It is, but you would then be able to tell, these talking points are coming directly from the Israeli government, that are being passed along to them by these registered foreign agents. And so they were coming up with strategies to avoid having to register some of these groups as registered foreign agents, because they're less effective if you know they're a mouthpiece for a foreign government. Yeah. And what makes AIPAC, and this is why AIPAC has never been forced to register under FARA, is that all of the staff members, the funding for the organization comes from Americans. They don't take grants from Israel, even though they functionally act in the United States as not just a mouthpiece for the Israeli government, as a mouthpiece for the right-wing party They're not just representing all of public opinion in Israel, because the public opinion in Israel is actually very divided, representing a very right-wing point of view in Israel. But because they're not getting direct subsidies or funding from Israel, they don't have to register under the foreign agents registration.
Right, but we can invite Netanyahu and Zelensky to come and speak to our Congress, and that doesn't influence anything.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's just remarkable. Steve Macek, it's always an enlightening interaction with you. It's always great to catch up with you.
It was great to talk to you. And yeah, I'm glad we covered the topics we did.
Foreign spending to influence U.S. election goes well beyond Russian covert operations. Are the corporate media paying attention? The short answer to that, Steve Macek, is not really. No,
not really.
Thanks so much for joining us. That wraps up another Project Censored show. Thanks so much for joining us today, and we'll see you all next time.
Thank you. We want to smash, crash, blast, smash, blast the system. We want to get it hype, get it live, get with the mission. We want the crowd loud. This pumping rhythm is hitting. We want to make it clear. We want. And that does it for another episode of the Project Censored show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Eleanor Goldfield, co-hosting with Mickey Huff. For this episode, I've also been your associate producer, and Anthony Fest is our senior producer. Project Censored Radio airs on roughly 50 stations across the U.S., from Maui to New York. And you can find all our previous archived programs by going to projectcensored.org. Please follow and like us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram just before we get deplatformed. And be sure to subscribe to the official Project Censored show on your digital tethering devices podcast application. Please feel free to contact us, share your feedback, or learn more about our work at projectcensored.org, and see our new publishing imprint, The Censored Press, at censoredpress.org. To learn more about my work or to contact me specifically, please visit my website at artkillingapathy.com. You can also follow me on social media at Radical Eleanor. Last but not least, thank you so much to our listeners for tuning in. We'll see you next time. Can't imagine a world without oppressive forces slaving for almighty dollar bills. We won. We got the love of the brothers and our sisters. The people together can overthrow the system. We got the love of the brothers and your sisters. The people together can overthrow the system. Perpetrated by the criminal minds, political ties, habitual lies, alibis, disguise, and other guys of democracy, politics, and the apocalypse. Got the skies looking ominous. So the ocean burn bright with waves full of poison. Genocide, wars, fall for little poison. The weapons manufactured paid for by attacks upon the bridges and the levees and the mines collapsing. All the prisons, build the capacity, citizens. And the ties with a master thief, combine and conquer, steal a masterpiece. Open your eyes and realize what's happening. Time's running out to reach all potential. If you ain't at the table, then you're probably on the menu. Tim Wise. So you can't have multicultural democracy and white hegemony. You're going to have to choose. I mean, this country is going to literally have to choose. And by the way, this also is why these issues surrounding great replacement tie in with the assault on women's reproductive autonomy, right? The idea that white folks want more white babies and white families, what's a great way to try to accomplish that, right? Restrict the bodily autonomy of women, in particular white women, so that they have to, you know, bear the children that they find themselves with when they become pregnant. So there's a connection, right, between the assault on women's reproductive autonomy and the great replacement theory and the anti-immigrant sentiment and this desire to maintain the country as a white nation.
Storytelling for social change on KPFA.
Guess what? You've got a genie in your pocket, but instead of granting wishes, it gives you KPFA. Just pull out your phone, go to kpfa.org, and hit the Listen Live button. Boom! Instant access to everything you love about KPFA. News, music, and stories that matter. No three wishes needed, just one click. So go ahead, unleash your KPFA genie. It's way cooler than a magic carpet ride. KPFA.org.
You're listening to The Indomitable, 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K24ABR in Santa Cruz, 94.3 K232FZ Monterey, and online at KPFB.